I deem it a great privilege to be before you to talk about a wonderful topic. I don't know who imagined this topic, public morality and constitutional morality. My dear students, the director of the institution, Mr. Sarfaraz Ahmed Khan, deputy director, my friend Anuradha, my friend, colleague, Dwarak, and the eminent people on the dais, the moderator of the panel discussion, Professor Ishwar Bhatt, and a person who is expert on two fields. It's a very, very rare combination. He's a literary personality and also a wonderful politician. Not a day passes without referring to his administrative law reforms books. Mr. Veerappa Moily, former Union Law Minister and Chief Minister of Karnataka, and Justice Swaminathan. I have an opportunity to hear him today. It's a great privilege and pleasure for me. And my friend G.B. Reddy, my colleague for decades, Usmania University friend. Happy to see all of you, my dear students. When I heard this topic, I remembered one joke. A young, brilliant personality was attempting to civil services examinations. He wrote 1,000 words article on dowry prohibition, how it impacts the society, how it will have an influence on the family and relationship of members of the family within all that wonderful article. And that article has really made him to be successful in civil services examinations. He passed. And do you know what he did immediately? He increased the rate of dowry and taken wonderful dowry and married a person. No, this man will be an officer. He will administer Indian Constitution. He will have special privileges under Indian Constitution. He will continue in office during the pleasure of the President of India. He has certain protections under the Constitution. What will happen? What kind of a administration we will have? Is a question of mixed question of individual morality, family morality, constitutional morality, and if you want to add, you can add public morality. So this is the problem. The second point I would like to bring before you is my experience in the Central Information Commission. There was a dispute between a husband and wife. Husband went for divorce petition. Court somehow rejected it. Now what is that he has to do? He should either go in appeal or should live with her. That is mandatory. This fellow has devised a very good strategy, alternative strategy. What is the strategy? He is a public sector unit's employee. I don't want to name the public sector unit also. He went to his colleagues, seniors, and suggested them to transfer him to a distant place about which it should not be informed to his wife. He got himself transferred. This poor lady doesn't know where the husband is. The management is issuing notices of eviction from the official residential quarter of such a high officer of a public sector undertaking. Nobody was coming to her rescue. She has to vacate. And some fellow said, why don't you file an RTA application? What for should I file an RTA application? To know where your husband is. What a great country. To know where my husband is, my wife is, I have to file an RTA application. And she filed. She was skeptical about it, but she filed. Then look at the institutional response. It says it is private and personal information of the officer. It cannot be given. Okay, then it went in first appeal. A senior most officer will be listening to the first appeal. And he says, it is third party information. You can't ask for it. Then it came to Central Information Commission because it is a central public authority. You also understand, when I narrate this, you also understand the importance of constitutional rights, which can be implemented through a small tool called right to information. You'll come to know about this with this incident. Then we were sitting there, and I was looking into the book, Right to Information Act. It says, the remuneration given to a public servant should be in public domain. The status, place of work, and the listed works of that public servant also should be in public place on their own. Nobody need to ask. It should be kept on their own. Then everybody should know Mr. X, the so-and-so officer, is working at so-and-so place, and he will be meeting from 10 to, he will be in the office from 10 to 5 p.m., and he can be met at around lunchtime or any other time which he gives. See, her question was, where is my husband? When can I meet him? That's all. This is the information she was asking. And then luckily, Central Information Commission gave, very fortunately, I can say that, she is entitled to that information, and the information was given. Look at the joy of that lady. She went all the way to northern place. He got himself transferred from South India to North India. She traveled all the way and caught hold of his collar and asked, where did you go? Where did you go? Don't ask me further details, none of our business, none of our concern. Can you imagine an effective usage of an ordinary rule of a legislation has resulted in union of husband and wife? What a fantastic combination it is. I really admire the effect of Right to Information Act in uniting the people or getting the people together. This is the, you tell me, sir, is it a legal question? Is it a penal law question? Is it a constitutional law question? Is it a question of public morality? Is it a question of individual morality? Is it a question of family morality? Is it a question of national morality? Come on, think about it. This is what I want to pose before you. And another similar incident I'll quote. A wife wanted to know the salary of the husband. Salary. And we are so great in our country, we blame governments to be secretive. Yes, governments are secretive. They don't tell anything what they are doing. We don't know anything. And what are we? We don't know what I'm earning. She's not asking how much you are spending, how you are spending your salary. She's asking, what is your salary? She's not asking for the share in the salary. She is asking for the information about the salary. If I am such a fantastic personality that I don't share where I am working, where I am being transferred, what is my salary, and what kind of a morality that I am implementing, and which law will bring this morality to you, I do not know. And if you say morality, it comes to my mind, a non-enforceable part of law is morality. Non-enforceable part of law is morality. Nobody can implement morality. And we are discussing the expression constitutional morality. What is constitutional morality? Entire constitution is morality. Do you know why? Because we are not implementing constitutions. That means constitution itself became an unenforceable document, a piece of paper. When you convert an entire constitution into an unenforceable piece of paper, we have to simply say that we are worried about constitutional morality. When national emergency was imposed, I was discussing this in my constitutional class in my university. A student asked me, sir, how the president signed it? President should have thought about what is being recommended. I'm not discussing individuals, I'm discussing an institutional and constitutional aspect. Then I went through, it was a very good question, which you don't get in your latest edition of the constitutional law. I was looking into history and how it was imposed. I read and I came through certain books. It took a lot of time from me. My preparation went waste because I had to do a fresh preparation. Do you know what I discovered? Presidential Bhavan was knocked, the doors of presidential were knocked at dead of night. A person brought a file into president opens it, and finds it very serious. I'm happy that he found it very serious. And then he asked his PS. PS came up. I request you to give hello. I request you to hear me, my dear friend. I want you to hear me. Then the president asked for, I would like to consult the copy of the constitution. He was asking for copy of the constitution. Yeah, in the dead of night, how do you get it? It will not be readily available, no? Then PS went through, he was searching for the library, searching for the book in the president's library, picked up one and came. By the time he came, one important person from the Prime Minister's office entered the Rashtrapati Bhavan, and then he left. Then he came back with the constitution copy and said, President, this is the constitution copy. I have already signed it. He has already signed it. The special emissary came to me from the PMO and he wanted me to sign the notification. I signed it. Now, you tell me, sir, whether Constitution of India is Indian Penal Code? Is it a penal law? Do you have any consequence available in the Constitution to punish somebody for not following the Constitution? When you don't have consequences, penal consequences for violation of Constitution, how do you term it as, why not you term it as morality? Entire Constitution is morality. Every principle of Constitution is morality. Somebody asked me in second appeal, sir, who is Ishwar? I'm not talking about Ishwar, but everybody knows Ishwar, but he's introduced. But how do I introduce Ishwar? And the Right to Information Act, how do I? Then we were having a video conference and the man appeared from the other side. He's some Sridhananda yogi, somebody. He said, sir, I asked, why should I answer your question? What question it is? How do I answer and why should I answer? No, sir, in the Constitution of India, there is a mention about Ishwar. I was surprised. Where is that you find Ishwar in the Constitution? Then I asked him, where is that? Though I'm a professor of constitutional law, for a while I lost it. You know, can anybody tell me where is it? Where do you find it? Do you find it or you don't find it? Anybody in the class, in the auditorium? Anybody who can find answer, please raise your hand. Do you find Ishwar in Indian Constitution? In oath of office, in the format of oath of office, it is provided that you can take oath in the name of Ishwar or according to your conscience. Now he wants to know, if Constitution has not defined Ishwar, how do I believe and how do I take oath in the name of Ishwar? Please define the Ishwar. That was his demand under second appeal. Now, can anybody answer this question? And my another point with this reference is, let us think about it. When he is elected by the people under the constitutional process, he is coming to office, parliament, office of parliament, why should he take oath to protect the constitution? Is it a legal requirement or a moral requirement? Or do you want somebody, during our childhood, suppose you say, no, I have not taken your book, my friend will ask, no, can you take kasam khate kya? Hum kasam khake bolna. Kasam kiski kasam? Maa ki kasam. Bhagwan ki kasam. Ishwar ki kasam. So, ye sab kya hai? You have entire constitution edifies wonderful book as just now explained by Mr. Veerappa Moily and my dear friend, Justice Swaminathan. They explained it. Now, what is it I have to do? Why should I take oath in the name of Ishwar and why in the name of my conscience? That means I want your further commitment, further moral commitment, individual commitment, your thinking, your conscious commitment I want. Because I have elected you to the office of Member of Parliament. And the problem is, we take oath to abide by the Constitution. We show our allegiance to Constitution established by law. Constitution established by law. We are neither no constitution, we don't know what is establishing it by law. We don't know. Now my point is, an MP who is just elected, who is not a law graduate, who is not a student of Symbiosis Law School, how does he know what the constitution is and how is that he will repose faith in allegiance to the constitution? So my demand from this August auditorium is, The moment elections are over, before the MPs and MLAs take oath, there should be an intensive session of training in Constitution of India, and all the panel members of this August auditorium should be called for training, including me. Then I can believe that they are going to really do something to protect the Constitution, to be the followers of the Constitution. This is the issue. You know, P.P. Rao, one of the most interesting and significant advocates of this country. He hails from Andhra Pradesh, this state, this part of the country. I am fortunate enough to say that I know him and he knows me. He went to his village a few years before his death. He went to his village in Prakasham district. Then he was sharing the experience of his village presence with me in a function in Delhi, in a book release function in Delhi. Sridhar, do you know what happened in my village? Sir, what happened? There was election, panchayat election. Two strong candidates are contesting very, very briskly. An entire village is full of campaign. People are spending lakhs of rupees in campaign. I said, it's common, sir. Everybody spends huge money to win the hearts of the people to get the votes. No, that is not the issue. Next day, one person came to me in my guest house and he knocked the doors and he says he wanted my blessings. I said, the election is not yet over now. Why do you need my blessings? Sir, election is over, sir. Election is over overnight. How does it came? It came to a conclusion. No, sir. My opponent has withdrawn from the contest. I won unanimously. There is a deal between two contesting candidates, and the deal resulted in one being declared elected. Rule of law. There is no violation of law anywhere. And now, what must have been the consideration for winning over an opposition candidate who is supposed to have won the election? What must have been the consideration? You can imagine. Then where is morality? Where is individual morality? Where is social morality? Where is institutional morality? Where is constitutional morality? So this is the issue. So entire law is fine. See, Constitution of India is not self-executing document. It cannot execute itself. It cannot have a provision against its misuse. It cannot have any provision against misuse of any absolute power that is available in the Constitution. You can't have any provision to misuse your freedom. Proper use of freedom is the moral question of Constitution. Proper use of authority is moral question of constitutional authority. Constitution, entire Constitution is edifice of morality. Entire law is edifice of morality. And if you don't implement Constitution, you can't implement morality. If I am not a responsible family member, I don't share my information with my own wife, what kind of a moral personality am I? And if I can't run my institution according to the notions of dispensation of knowledge, what kind of an institutional morality it is? And if I can't conduct myself in constitutional office, I am supposed to be independent. I am not independent. I will not give any judgment according to law. I will not take any decision according to Constitution. I will not consult my cabinet colleagues. I will not inform the persons about what decision I am going to take. I met Raghuram Rajan in the airports. I introduced myself as information commissioner. He asked me, I was very hesitant to ask about demonetization. Then he himself raised a question. Professor, I would like to know, is there any duty on the government to inform the people about the decisions they are going to take? Sir, where is the doubt? Where is the doubt? Section 4.1b of Right to Information Act says, whatever decision you are going to, 4.1c and 4.1d, three subsections, they say, whatever decision you take, if it has an impact on the public, every member of the public who is going to suffer the impact of your decision must know the facts and circumstances of the decision. Nobody need to ask for it. You have to tell on your own. Are we doing it? So what is constitutional morality is based on public morality. You have raised a wonderful topic. I appreciate you. And I also read your book of research book on compilation of the cases which talk about constitutional morality, public morality. I appreciate your team. You have done a wonderful job. You have done a wonderful job. You have listed out. In fact, you have completed 50% of analysis of constitutional morality. But what I would like to say is, each and every provision of constitution talks about morality. Do you remember H.R. Khanna's dissent in ADM Jabalpur case? Have you studied? Have you studied? Yes, you have studied. Fundamental right can be suspended. How can you suspend fundamental right to live? If you suspend fundamental right to life, you will die and you cannot revive the suspended right. A very simple question of common sense. You don't need to be a philosopher of the Constitution of India. It is enough if you know that if a person killed cannot be revived, you cannot suspend his right to life. It's a common question. It's a natural question. It's a moral question. And I'm surprised that majority of the judges did not think of this moral question, natural question, basic question of life. Constitution doesn't talk about it. Constitution need not talk about it. Constitution presumes that you are a natural human being, you have natural sense, and you will apply your mind naturally. That is the belief of the Constitution. And what are we doing? So I want to, all of you to think about morality. If there is no morality, there is no family. If there is no morality, there is no education. If there is no morality, there is no constitution. If there is no morality, there is no democracy. Absolutely no democracy. And if you think that we have democracy without public morality, I am surprised at your intelligence. That's what I can say. There are so many issues I can talk about. Now, you know, there is one, my time is up. I'll conclude with one point. There is one point in the Constitution which nobody talks about. One expression, you will find it in preamble, fraternity. Fraternity. We don't know what is the meaning of fraternity. We have case law on secularism, we have case law on that policy, this policy, but we don't have any understanding of fraternity. Ambedkar says we cannot call ourselves a nation because we are divided, we don't have fraternity. When you have fraternity and we are, when you are really integrated, you are constitutionally strong person and you are a nation. We are yet to become a nation. We are yet to become a moral individual. We are yet to become a citizen, a vibrant citizen of this constitution, this rule of law. We are yet to become. So I wish this seminar inculcates an idea in your minds that first we should become vibrant citizens of this country. We should educate our colleagues and co-citizens about what is to happen. And then you can think of public morality, you can think of constitutional morality, you can implement rule of law, not ruler's law, but rule of law. Thank you very much. Thank you.